What's up, guys? My name is Ryan Luth. I'm a filmmaker based out of Southern California, and today we're going to be talking about how to film a moving car scene. So today we're going to be looking at an example from a scene from a short film that I was DP and co-director on a couple years ago. There was lots of moving car shots in it where we had to rig out the car on hood mounts and a hostess tray or side mounts and all that fun stuff. So it was really cool. So let's take a look at the clip.
Hey, I've already told you, you can't skate here. Get away.
Don't listen to him. He's only a grumpy old man.
What are you doing?
You'll see. I mean, Mr. McGillicuddy has been a real jerk to me ever since I was a kid. It is finally payback time.
Who is Mr. McGillicuddy?
Oh, dude, you'll see. Just make this left. Trust me. Everything is gonna be okay.
So this particular scene was part of a larger project. This is a proof of concept short film. It's a really fun project to work on. We shot on the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera 4K, which worked really well for these car rig shots because having something really light for these was really good, so we didn't have to put too much of a heavy camera on the hood or on the side. We had a little bit more leeway with how we were rigging those. And then the second camera we were shooting on was the Red Dragon. I believe it was 6K, might be getting that wrong. And that was rigged out on the Ronin 2. We had that on a ready rig and that was going off of a golf cart. So that's how we got all those like moving shots. Let's talk a little bit about the location. The majority of this particular scene takes place in front of this white house with this red door. Now, this was actually the house I was living at the time when we were filming this, so it worked out really well. We were able to just hop in and shoot it, but it also worked out really well because of the way that it was laid out. When I was storyboarding this out, I wanted to make sure that I could find a house that had a big yard in the front for the old angry man to be sitting in a chair with his newspaper, and then also it had to be on this side of the road because of the lighting and stuff, which did change on the day. It was overcast, so that didn't affect it too much, but having him right here and then the car being able to pull up on the right side, right up to him, throw the water balloon and take off again, worked really well with the way that everything was kind of placed. Let's do a little bit of a quick scene breakdown from beginning to end. So obviously it starts off with this drone shot and then moves into the license plate. Drone shot was really easy. We just had a drone op who was able to just fly overhead and we got a bunch of different variety of shots that we were doing for that. This is one of my favorite shots as we're coming in here. It gets up on the license plate and it kind of pulls up around and then it lands on our character driving the car. And punches out to a wide shot. Now, that was obviously not absolutely necessary and something that had to be done, but I really, really wanted to try and get this shot in there because I felt it established it really well. It was a great, like, landing you on the California license plate, bringing it up and around, just kind of establishes the surfer California style of this car, and then you see the surfboards on the top. All of this stuff was done on that Ronin 2 we were filming out of the golf carts. I had to time the moving car along with the golf cart as we panned and tilted around to frame up to our character in the side of the car who was driving. Then we land in this shot of the house. So we're establishing the house, we're seeing these two little skater kids out here that are annoying this old man. I was trying to figure out, okay, how do I keep this interesting and make it feel like the man is kind of like overpowering and into frame? And so I had him step in front of the camera so you see his feet kind of come in and these guys are like looking up at him like, oh no. And then we cut to this shot looking up at him. So a cool thing you can do when you're filming any sort of dialogue or narrative kind of filmmaking is shooting up towards someone, like kind of booming down and tilting up will establish a bit more of like a dominance of that person. It's a little bit more intimidating. And then you shoot the reverse shot of the person they're talking to, boomed up and a little bit tilted down. So it's kind of like a more like vulnerability kind of thing. And then it shows who kind of has the higher power in the scene and who is maybe not so much confident. So this worked well with this grumpy old man looking down on these little kids. It just worked well. So he yells at them, tells them to get away. And then we just did a handheld tracking shot as they start to walk away. Boom, transition, couple shots into the gremlin again. So then we jump into the hood shot. This car, by the way, was super awesome. It's an AMC Gremlin 1976, I think. Super fun car to work with. Really enjoyed it and it was a lot of fun. Basically what we did here is we got a bunch of big suction cups. So this was just something that we rented out from a rental house up in LA. Obviously made sure the owner of this car was okay with us putting these on here. He was totally fine. And so we got these big, massive suction cups to rig off of. We put two down near the front, closer to where the camera is gonna be, and then a couple smaller ones up near the windshield. And then kind of had to triangulate it up to the camera sitting in the middle. Now, I know this isn't necessarily the most traditional way to do a hood mount. If you've watched any other grips or seen any key grips on set doing this, they'll often use some speed rail and a cheese plate, and they'll kind of just use some, sometimes it's sandbags, sometimes it's ferny blankets, and they'll ratchet strap and sometimes suction cup it onto the hood on this kind of like stretcher looking thing. But we just didn't have the equipment to do that or any key grips on set. So this worked out well for us. We just used some C-stammed arms, and it comes with a lot of these little smaller ones. I think it was a Matthews hood mount. I could put the link below. But it worked well, and we basically just triangulated the camera right into the middle using our C-stand arms and all of our grip heads. And then on the top here, you'll see there's these two little ones that go up. It might actually just be one. So there's one that goes up, and there's a little, like, tiny little pin on the top that you screw into the cold shoe of the camera or onto whatever you can fit it onto. And basically what that does is it keeps the camera from rocking around so that the weight is distributed evenly out over the hood and it's not wobbling around, and you have a point of contact on the top of your camera. These were a little bit more difficult in a sense, just because of framing up the shots in the way that I wanted it, so it wasn't too low and not too high. In a perfect world, you'd have what's called a hostess tray, but we didn't have that, and also didn't have any key grips or anything on set. I was kind of doing a lot of everything, wearing a lot of hats. So what we did is just take the suction cups that we had, and we had to work with it. So we put two big, massive ones on the side of the doors. That's kind of where the main part of our weight was gonna be, and then ran a C-stand arm along that. Now, obviously it stayed there, but we needed to triangulate and find other points of contact for a camera so it's not wobbling around or falls off, which we don't want to happen. So same kind of thing, we had that little tiny little spud sticking off the top handle of the Blackmagic, and then use a tiny little C-stand arms and brought that up onto the top of the car with a suction cup, and then another one going off to the side on the back window. So that was enough to hold it in place pretty solid. Now, in the future, I would have loved to have had this up a little bit higher, which in a sense would have worked well for the hostess tray, but we just weren't able to do this with the grip gear that we had. But we worked with what we had and worked out well. Sometimes you just have to work with what you got, and it doesn't always turn out exactly how you want, but I was pretty happy with it for the most part. Then all of this extra stuff was just shot on sticks. We follow him up with the water balloon. This took so many tries, I remember. Little inserts, and he drives off away. And then it's a little shot of the kids run alongside as if it's like his POV looking out the window. So then lighting wise for this, pretty simple. I just kept natural light. It worked well with the whole overcast clouds that we had going on. Was really great. Worked to our benefit. In a perfect world, I would have had some sky panels and stuff rigged off of the top, and we could really light them properly and stuff, but we had a lot of natural light to work with, and that was kind of the style we were going for anyway. So all we did was took a little quasar, I think it was a little battery powered quasar or something like that, and we just gaff taped it and tried to fit it into the the dashboard underneath of the radio and stuff to get a little bit of a lift on their face. But then these side shots, same kind of thing. You can't see it in here, and we did actually a pretty decent job, I think, of hiding it, but the light is sitting right behind our gear shift, whatever you want to call it. And that's why the glove compartment is open. So it's actually sitting in the glove compartment because we didn't really have any other place to hide it. So as you watch through, that's giving a little bit of an uplight on his face just to add something. You know, you kind of have to find out where to put lights in order to do this when you're filming in a car like this, and this just worked out for what we had. A little bit of camera logistics, everything that we were doing off the Blackmagic. So that was the Blackmagic Pocket Cinema 4K, and we had I think it was just a 20 millimeter Rokinon Cine Prime on that, and I'm pretty sure we had some quarter black pro mist as well. And then obviously we wanted to be able to transmit feed back to our director's monitor, first AC to pull focus. So this is just one of those ghost eyes transmitters on the top of here. Worked pretty well. It's a little big and kind of clunky, and didn't really like that too much about it, but it transmitted fine. We didn't have any issues with it, so it worked the same as a Teradek. Big part of when you have a lot of moving parts in a scene, especially where your actors and your cast is going off somewhere else and your video village is back at base, or people are going all over the place and moving cars. Biggest thing that helped us so much was having radios. Radios, walkies, whatever you want to call them, was a lifesaver because you're able to communicate with people where they're going, and it just helped us save a lot of time. So that's a tip. Have radios on set, have walkies on set. It'll help your production process just go a lot faster. Looking back on it, anything I would do differently in the future, lighting wise, I would have loved to have played around with that a lot more, used less natural light and put some lights up on the hood for those side shots. So thank you guys again so much for watching. Hope this helps inspire you guys and helps you guys in any filmmaking journeys and endeavors you might be on. And as always, don't forget to like and subscribe, hit that notification bell so you know when I'm releasing another video, and we'll see you on the next one.